Bristol.
Iron Bristol Mid even?
That could be it. Omni offlane, but Omni, yeah. Omni offlane is not going to have a good time here against PL Dazzle.
Well, insta PL pick, and there's your defusal buyer right there. Like, this is, it's not even. I feel like LGD wanted this hero regardless because they picked
it
up
just
so quickly.
It happens to work out even better here.
Yeah, they banned the Shadow Demon, but like, it has the purge against the Omni Knight, and they do need a secondary support. Good synergy between Shadow Demon Dazzle with Disruption, Shadow Wave, but.
That Ember could have been really nice, counter to the illusions. Gyro's already banned out.
They need damage output. Like, you've got Wyvern, Ire, Omni Knight. No damage
from these three defensive heroes.
Even Bristle, like, he has some right-click damage, but if he's getting kited and the Shadow Wave, the Weave, it's all physical. You need...
I mean, it's not a Naga, right? It's got to be something else here.
Alina mid, maybe? Or Zeus?
Zeus feels a little... Well, I guess he's got a lot of heals to back him up.
I mean, Lina to me seems like one of the better picks here, as far as damage output goes. But the QO Slark, another classic. So they're going with... They're kind of more comfort zone.
It's a rare game where Slark isn't terrible, because I feel like every game now we see some massive combination of AoE heroes. Queen of Pain, Shadow Fiend... If ever not banned, the Lashrak, of course, Gyrocopter. That's where Slark really feels like he's fallen off. Just too many heroes that can damage him, even when he's in the ultimate. But there's only Shadow Fiend right now. And they've already picked up the Dazzle as a support. So this could be a game where Slark gets out of control. And I believe MVP had a really nice showing with the QO Slark in the wildcard qualifier in one of their games.
So
reserve time.
It's a playmaking hero.
Yeah, and LGD, their last pick will probably be geared up for dealing with this. Get something like a Lion or a Sand King. Get an AoE stun. Get some control and lockdown.
Sand King. Now there's a hero I haven't seen in a long time.
Lina. Lina, not. But I mean, tons of damage output here, and Jawei just loves it.
So. And it's AoE. AoE versus the Slark. Always nice. And you can just burst the Wisp if you get the finger out.
Yeah, and having magic damage against the Wyvern, the Cold Embrace, also goes a long way. So, a good hero and a hero that they will probably... I mean, Zhao Wei generally becomes kind of the actual three-position player as far as farm party goes, so you get an Aghanim Scepter that's good against the Bristleback with the pure damage. It's just a nice pick. KP!
So he's going mid on the Omni and then save point Slark, I'm guessing?
They actually run Slark mid time to time. I guess it could be
two dual lanes and then an Omni solo save?
I almost feel
Slark is not going to have fun 1v1 against Shadow Fiend.
Io is going to have to help out whoever's going mid, and I think
you could just solo Bristle offlane and do like a Slark Wisp mid. That wouldn't be terrible.
Omni KP has occasionally gone offlane when March has played like his Warlock. March plays the Bristle. I mean, it's not the only Bristleback on the team. It's not the most complicated hero. I feel like it could be Io Bristle mid and Omni in the offlane, but. We'll have to wait and see. KP's kind of gone for the Mango. This could be offlane items.
Yeah, more. It looks like more of a self-sufficient build, not trying to get an early Sol Ring out or anything like
if
that.
If he was going mid with the Wisp, he probably wouldn't buy these items. It looks like QO with the Poor Man's Shield Salve is
going to... I think he's going bottom, and then... So it looks like Bristle maybe left to his own top. If March really needs help, he'll get it. But most likely it will be the dual lane mid and then a dual lane bottom. So
we saw last game how powerful Wisp rotations can be. So you can start off the Bristle solo, but have a surprise Wisp rotation. And suddenly you think you may be going for a kill and it gets turned around by the Io showing up. And Io gets a whole lot stronger when he's level 2, level 3. You get points in overcharge, you get the spirits out. So maybe they leave March solo and then just have a surprise gank from the Wisp.
Let's get into it. MVP searching for a win here to prevent LGD from completely overrunning Group A. If they can win this game, LGD stays well within the pack, and by no means is a guarantee to be top four, but based on how well LGD's been playing to date, it feels like they're a strong threat at this point. LGD dire side, they opted for first pick again. And I have to say, gods, there has been an emerging and consistent trend, at least in all the games we've cast, of teams always wanting first pick. There was a handful, I think we had one team that wanted Radiant the other day, but as the team that won the coin toss, but by and large it has been, if you have the won coin toss, you get first pick every time.
I think first picks had more success than the Radiant side for them. I'll be curious to see, especially towards the end of the group stage, and looking at some of the closer games maybe, like taking out some of the top teams versus bottom teams games. But we'll see how things develop here. For now, Omni Knight... Very self-sufficient, as you mentioned, with this item build. That means they can kind of leave him solo. Wyvern can help out mid, can help out top. Both Wyvern and Io are very free to move around the map, stack jungle camps in the case of the Wisp, and Omni Knight should be just fine 1v1 against the Talus, kind of like he saw last game with the Daxia.
He's a really strong melee versus melee hero. He's got 5 base armor, and he's always got the heal to trade blows. So if you ever start to lose an engagement, just pop your pure damage heal, and you're almost guaranteed to be on top. Even at level 1, it's 180 HP swing. That is a lot.
Yeah, the KP's zoning while not missing a single last hit so far. So this is really good laning coming out from the Omni Knight.
I think this is basically the dream. Dowit, oh no, he's gonna deep
that ward like on top of Lina. Yeah, that was
weird because he already had gotten auto attacked. It was like right as he planted it. Bit unfortunate.
He probably already clicked it and didn't end up canceling.
Well, not ideal. Xiaowei was ready. I think just sitting here to protect maybe more so than to block the Nuts rotation. But as it turns out, that was exactly what Nuts wanted to ward. Bit unfortunate.
Yep. I think that the laning setup is pretty strong for MVP. The fact they can get away with freely just stacking their jungle. The mid lane QO should... I mean, he's got both supports dedicated to helping him, which is... This is standard MVP, you know? I mean, it's not necessarily like the... I mean, this is the MVP style. Like, protect Q in the mid lane, leave KP alone generally. Like, normally, when he's playing Naga, the problem is you can't just leave him to solo. But he's been playing Gyrocopter a lot, he's played a game of Razor. When he plays these heroes, they much more prioritize...
Oh, they want Xiaowei, they go in with the leap, then the tether slow comes through, but Xiaowei has the stun. And they need to be careful, the double raise, wow. This could be a twofer, and maybe he's gonna get the double kill! All of that good laning setup gone in a flash. That was an extremely risky go by MVP. Yeah. They knew the Lina was there, they knew the Shadow Fiend could rotate, and they just thought they could get the pounce. But even if they hit the pounce,
they had no extra damage.
I think at best they walk away. They're not getting the kill there, and well, we saw what happens at worst.
Level 2 Slark, they didn't have Wyvern with them, and even if they did, Arctic Burn was still on cooldown, so...
Yeah, it's only a level 1. Level 1 pounce does no damage. It does 50 damage.
Alright, that is
beyond insignificant. And now maybe a 17 souls, and I mean, he can just go in. If the Wisp runs to auto attack him, he can just dive. Speaking of going in, that's what March wants to do here. He has the DD rune. He wants to get close on somebody and then start auto attacking them only when they're low. So he doesn't draw the Taro aggro, but March just spamming up the quills. They've decided to move Feppy here, trying to take advantage of this top lane. Does mean less support for a Slark, and they're giving support away for the Slark after they gave up the double kill. Gonna be tough, but maybe KP can make the plays bottom lane. He rushes in with the boots now complete. He gets the heal bomb and the solo kill. And with that first kill, Omni Knight can really take over. Pusk is not gonna be able to handle this 1v1.
Yeah, this is a brutal lane. KP is getting out of control on the Omni Knight. So this is good news for MVP because mid kind of falling apart. They have got the stack still going, which they can fall back to, although they don't... I mean, the Bristleback, obviously, the one who's likely to be farming those, but it doesn't help the Slark catch up. And right now, Slark just 7 CS. He can't lane here against the Shadow Fiend, not without huge support. Even the Wyvern alone can't even zone the Shadow Fiend. Shadow Fiend's already level 5. He's just going to turn and raise anyone who tries to harass him. So this is actually a really problematic lane for them. Oh, Febby.
Uh-oh. He was trying to stack the ancients, and he tethers away. One more auto attack, bottling up. Good escape by Febby. But now they've scouted the ancients. They're going to deploy a ward, and they'll know if these are farmed. Meanwhile, KP doing KP things bottom. He's going to have a heal soon. Actually, no, he doesn't have the mana for it. He's got a bottle charge, and he pops it, but the creeps are going to cancel it, and the TP comes in. That pesky range creep denying him a precious kill. Did force out the teleport scroll, though. And this lane is one. This is a one lane.
It's one of those fun things where you can like play a safe lane solo that has that huge advantage in lane, and it's something where LGD run a lot of weak offlaners. Yeah, I was often playing heroes like Tusk and Earthshaker, which there's a lot of bad 1v1 matchups for these heroes that you can look to exploit, so I like that MVP have done this.
Doppelganger backed by Sylar, healed up by MMY. But this mid lane is my concern, gods. This is the Slark. Maybe they rotate him off the lane, catch him up a bit later on, but until you get 6, if you're Slark in this matchup, you can't really go in for CS because you don't have the ult to heal you up. He's only now, just now getting his bottle, and one raise, it's basically half your health. It's just, it's beyond impossible to CS, even under his tower. Normally, Kyo has been getting denied. He manages to combo together last hit there, but You can see Shadowfiend has more denies than Slark has denies and last hits combined. They make their go on Yao, and he's got nothing to snowball to. Oh, he snowballs forward. The heal isn't going to connect, but they drag it back. But with the Shadowfiend rotation, they're actually going to have to run from this. They may even end up finding a kill here on KP. Maybe looking, there's a repel just available.
Yeah, if he'd held the heal or canceled it.
Well, that's still big for QO, though. Now QO gets a couple of CS. Oh, he gets a little breathing room.
That's a good point. That's really handy for him. And that's the big thing here. QO is probably like, I'm struggling, I can't farm, but where do I catch up? He can't farm jungle sex. He's a Slark. He can't, I mean, he could say, oh, give me the safe lane, but then KP can't lane against the Shadow Fiend either. So at that point, KP's going to have nowhere to go. So it's kind of like they had to tough it out. That rotation from Shadow Fiend, though, does help out a little bit, but see if QO can continue to find the catch-up farm he needs.
And he also gets a rune because of that. Otherwise, maybe we see LGD grab both runes, but that they're only going to get the bottom, which was a regen. The dream Shadow Fiend game. The early double kill, the max souls as soon as possible, and now free farm for maybe. Now he's going to be a beast. And looking at the jungle, you already see a triple stack coming out for his big camp. And meanwhile, the Radiant jungle, only that pair of double stacks, which was the around the 1 minute mark that those were created.
And we will be looking at like a repelled Slark in these mid game fights. So if Kyo can find some items here, he can be a big menace for LPD to deal with. Especially like before the SF gets like a BKB, he goes probably see like a mech build come out of maybe. You can really fight into that with the Omni Knight sustain. This is a very high level farmed Omni Knight. He's gonna offer a lot to the team. Not gonna go for like any kind of gimmicky carry Omni Knight. It's probably just gonna be like a, I mean, he's got the arcane boost, maybe we see a mech or a four star.
Trapped him by the creeps. He's gotta put himself under the cold embrace. There is now a heal available from KP. Tried to zone with the first skill, the Arctic Burn, but at this point it's just not that scary for Yao, who has the stout shield and the boots. Can just walk and tank up, so. Bit of a waste there, but he'll just back off and go back to... Looks like he'll go back to pulling.
Yo hit level 6, so now he does have the Shadow Dance available to him, and I like this kind of playstyle from MVP. They're not going for any kind of cheesiness with the Naga Siren this time around. They're just going for one of their kind of polished... not really polished, but one of their kind of unconventional funky strats. The Io Bristleback, not really the duo that it normally has been for them, but the Omni Knight, laning dominance, the QO Slark, a comfortable pick for them, and now they're going to start farming their stacks, and something that LGD really aren't in the best position to contest, even with the ward here, although here comes Shadowfiend.
LGD coming at almost the exact right time. They're going to get one last hit on the Triceratops, and they look for March, who's barely able to get away, but not so lucky as the QO Slark. He ran in to help, and he just melts to the raises. That's all it took, I think, maybe just with two raises.
Double raise, yeah.
It's a level 4 raise, and Slark has no HP items. That just can't happen. Giving up the Aegis is one thing, but when you give up kills on your Slark, who's only just starting to get back in the game, it really, really hurts. And now LGD on the back of that kill. They look for the push mid. They pressure the tower. Omni Knight, the one hero who could really do a lot in an upcoming fight, as March goes on to Sylar. He'll doppelganger back, but March is going to pursue. He's going to force something, punish this push on the mid lane, and he's going for it fully. Snowball to turn this one. March, might have gone in too deep. The heal comes out. He continues to quill up.
Punch him.
Laura's punch, not enough. Meanwhile, Febby dies mid. It's two more kills going the way of LGD, and Nuts is going to be next, maybe just trucking his way through this middle lane. He says, I want the tower too. You best back or I'm going to take you down again, QO. Oh, sheesh. You look back at that early double kill, totally avoidable for MVP, and ever so costly. Now they've got a 6k net worth Shadow Fiend who has a completed mech in his stash and 9 minutes just waiting, and that's going to take away everything the Bristleback brings to the table.
You look at the Omni Knight, he's dominated this lane, he got a solo kill, and he's 2.5k net worth behind the Shadow Fiend. This has just been a stellar performance from maybe, and he's had a very easy lane. Laning mid against the Slark, that is like the dream lane. And he's had the support from Zhao Wei to help deal with the Wyvern, to help deal with the Wisp in the lane. So it hasn't been maybe just all on his own making this happen, but it's been a very good showing from him so far at TI5.
Entry ward getting dropped down just to make sure these Ancients can be stacked. They're going to go for the 2 support pull and also the D ward at the same moment. Oh, will they get out of range for the spawn? No, they missed the stack. Unfortunate. Didn't get the ward until afterwards. And now everyone on LGD is starting to get a little more space on the back of maybe's early showing. Zhao Wei, he's hit level 6 now. He's a threat to QO as well with this Laguna Blade. If QO gets stunned or drops to about half health, that Laguna's an instant kill, and he's even using Dark Pack to farm the wave. They could snowball in, and if he's not quick on the jump out, he does leap, and he does ultimate. They still may kill him with nukes. QO barely juking through the trees, just running for his life. And meanwhile, on the top lane, they managed to bring down Siler on the PL. Big exchange there, not losing the Snark and getting the PL kill, looking for more as KP hammers away at MMY. He'll find the second. And QO, again, the magnificent great escape, but they snowball after him. They want him so bad. Dark Pack gonna remove this stun, but not fast enough. There's just no running for QO. It's gone from some mistakes on his part to just no mercy from LGD. Full commitment for that one. Still a 2-for-1 around the map. And it will be a tower for a tower here. So MVP coming out the victors in that sense.
Yeah. Finding something on the map that the
difference feels like LGD have multiple sources of damage, and MVP's only damage outside of this Slark is the Bristleback, and there's a mech to counter the Quill'Dam, as well as the Dazzle Weave, which is now online.
Yeah, the physical damage, that's not going to be a big problem. Slark just needs his levels and like basic, cheap, cost-effective items. Get a Trench, get a Drums, and then you can work around having the Repel on yourself, but maybe even goes for a Blink Dagger just so he can blink in with Repel and do as much damage as possible. He's kind of the magic damage with Radiant's Pounce as well as Dark Pack, but it's going to be so tricky for him just because of how poor of a start he's had.
KP has just opted for a Midas now. He feels he needs even more farm to keep the team alive, but I quite like the choice. I don't think they're winning anytime soon, and he's already got most of his key levels out. Oh, QO, this can't happen again. It's 30 seconds until he can TP out. He does have his ultimate. Maybe he pounces into the trees and lives to fight another day, but not if the snowball connects. QO, again and again, they feast upon him. LGD make it 4 deaths for the poor Slark. He just can't catch a break, gods.
Yeah, it's all the attention on him, and having the Slark mid, very risky, volatile way of playing the hero, and it's just been punished. They had both supports kind of dedicated somewhat to his lane, or at least stacking, but it's not worked out at all for MVP.
Well, March does have his mech now for MVP, so they are looking strong in terms of the sustain in these fights. They have a mech, as well as, of course, the Omni Knight heal and repel, and they can just throw that repel on March if they want him to run in. Dumb solutions here, but meanwhile, the Wyvern gets picked off solo. There's a kill. They're looking for a trade with the relocate. And diving on Diao, who throws out the ice shards, almost keeps Febby away from Arch. Not quite, though. Grave available, and they hold it until the last second. Well played by MMY. Still the chase. This is about to end. This relocate, and they don't get that kill. They end up going back for the Requiem Bomb. Was waiting for the Iowa. Febby blows him up instantly, and KP will die as well to a lance. Then March falls next. 4 down for the count. The lone survivor this time is QO, but that's just too much. Maybe was so ready. Runloads the Requiem directly on top of the Wisp. Nothing you could do about that. Absolutely nothing but die. 7-0-2, out of control. Absolutely out of control.
Having 630 GPM at 12 minutes is just unheard of. Like, you can reach like 800, 900 plus GPMs, but that's when you're playing like a farming carry and you use your items to get you GPMs. And he's got nothing but mech and treads and seeing it now 650 GPM. This is insane performance and showing from the young LGD star.
Ish. Well, at this point, I think LGD, they can just walk into the Roche Pit, gods. They've got the heals, they've got the minus armor. If they want to get the lanes pushed out first, that's certainly fine, but the opportunity is there. Maybe some aggressive wards will be next. Chao8 moving into place one, but they are scouted out. And there's your Witness Curse. Could be a good opportunity here to get a kill. Not quick enough, though. The Grave comes out. Chao8 looking for the TP away. He's going to make it. MMY next. Where are the stuns? They don't have any. They can't stop the TPs. And they will fail to find kills again. MVP. Nothing. Just nothing going their way. And everything going the way of LGD.
Game Broody maybe now picks up a Yasha. I think we see an SMY build out of him.
This is a great SMY game. You are just so out of control if he wants to go for it.
I mean, we see the problem there. There's no lockdown. We didn't talk about it during the draft, but their only disable is that Winter's Curse. That's just not going to cut it. Especially
going in.
This far behind.
Debbie's the one repel that leaves March a bit vulnerable. KP also doesn't have a self-repel as Yao catches him in with the shards. He's forced to Guardian Angel very early in the fight. March engaging, but the nuke damage means this isn't really that strong of a defensive play. So MVP forced to back out as maybe and Yao push their way in. They have shards at the ready. Not going to pop them yet. Bringing the Phantom Lancer of Sandler into position. He's got his Diffusal Blade now. And the safe lane Omni Knight finds himself countered only 15 minutes into the game. Oh, LGD. They're in pole position now.
Yep, they've got great vision up. They have that in the jungle of MVP Phoenix that also sees into the mid lane. And they go for Roshan. They may have to give up their mid tier 1 tower for this, but I think they can actually defend it while taking Roshan. That's where Zhao Wei's already headed with the Tusk.
There's your Sanjin Yasha. 16 minutes. This is normally like a 20-minute item on Shadow Fiend with this build-up, but throwing Aegis on top. Maybe level 13. He's ready to just walk down mid. Maybe they go top first where there is a tier 1 standing, but one thing is for sure, LGD are going to take more objectives. They will not sit back and farm. No siree.
Coming up, LGD so far in game number 2. This has been a fantastic showing. This has been probably the most dominant team so far here at TI5. Secret with the one loss against Fnatic, although we haven't really seen what Secret's truly capable of yet, but LGD they've delivered.
It sets up for a very exciting day tomorrow, potentially, with these teams, I believe, set to face off then.
Yeah.
So, should be a lot of fun, but get through this game first. LGD haven't quite won just yet, although they're getting to that point where it feels like they can just walk down mid. And MVP, you have to worry about the psychology of it all more than anything. They do find Femi and they snowball on him, and before the repel comes out, he gets Walrus Punch and dead. KP now tries to TP out, but the raises prevent it. A quick double kill, a monster kill streak for Maybe, and a trail of dead bodies lie in his wake as he plunges down the middle lane. He's looking for X.
Yeah,
I forget about top. I mean, there's a free tier 1. Siler's like, guys, we can take this first and then go mid.
They can't fight. They can't really defend. They've gone for these double minuses. Not by no means the wrong items. When you're this far behind, you have to go for these kind of desperation, drag the game on items. But you've got a team on your high ground 70 minutes in with an Aegis SF with this farm. Oh boy, you're in trouble.
And there's just no play here for MVP. They don't have that Naga, Darkseer, you know, Disruptor type of lineup where an Earthshaker, a Magnus, something that can just change the game with a big ultimate. They have heroes that can change the game through a slow, drawn-out fight. An Omni Knight, a Bristleback, and these fights are not slow, guys. They're ending in 5-10 seconds with MVP all dead. And so now they relocate on mid. They're going to try to rat this out. MVP, they're using the relocate to get some extra gold. Could make a difference here for the upcoming fight. And they should be able to take the tier 1 down. It's going to be close, though. Relocate ending in 2 seconds. Might end up getting denied. They barely grab it, and they get out in time. Nice for MVP. They don't take the bottom tower, though. Sylar did hold them off there. I guess Slark is Midas. Hewa will begin the slow and painful process of trying to catch back up, but already Shaowei. Oh, he's just started farming. Shaowei, have mercy. Hewa needs a little time. The stun narrowly missing. He can just throw the Laguna here if he gets in danger, and Hewa will leap to the low ground. TP's out. Dazzle Weave gives them vision. No stun. I think time to go down bottom is the call for LGD.
And to me, it's like, let's say MVP do drag this game. If it goes 30, 40 minutes in, LGD have the much better late game here. Shadow Fiend PL as your two carries. You've got the utility of the Tusk. Walrus Punch to go through any BKB carries, as well as going through Repel. Dazzle is an insane here in the late game with Weave, Grave, Shadow Waves, whatever it may be. Lina scales amazingly well and is farming items as well. So MVP don't even come close to what LGD's potential is in the late game scenario. The only chance MVP have, like, in the mid to late game is getting an insane Winter's Curse where you get, like, Shadow Fiend next to a PL and one of them kills the other or something, but LGD could just fall back and farm for 20 minutes. By no means do they need to. They want to end this game as fast as possible and get on with it.
Oh, they're going to go on March. He turns his back. The Wiz comes in. They even put him under courtesy of the Cold Embrace, well, and they will keep him alive for now. It is a lot of defensive power, but now it's all in cooldown. And they're walking in again and working on the tower. Maybe take some damage. March continue to keep his back turned as he looks to stall out this push. Now GD, with some sustainer of their own from the Dazzle, the bottle charges keep on pressing in. This is giving QO time. He's split pushing top guts. He's looking to make space for his team. And LGD, they decide, we can't do it just yet. Let's push out the lanes, farm the enemy jungle a bit more. There's the Dazzle Drums, just another utility item. They may wait for the next Rosh if they're not feeling super confident.
Yeah, they can wait. They don't have to wait. It's very much To me, it's just like, I do not see LGD. There's no way I think they can really lose this game unless they make huge misplays or running into Winter's Curse with five heroes.
Yeah.
At no point does Slark really become relevant. He's so far behind. The Midas is going to catch him up on levels and help make sure he farms items towards the late game, but this hero won't be able to fight a Shadow Fiend or a PL. It just doesn't match up against these kind of carriers, especially when you're going to be under-farmed compared to them.
And on top of that, there's Alina in the picture with an Aghanim's Laguna Blade coming, at which point you're always going to lose about half your health off the bat.
Even if you're a Pelvisock, he's not guaranteed to stay alive.
Nuts. I just wanted to ward, but not going to happen. He puts himself under with the Cold Embrace, but only delays the inevitable here as Yao continues to go to work. Another Ice Shards, a heal. MMY says, I'll take that. Another kill for LGD. Make it 15-3 as they continue to just starve out MVP as much as possible. We'll see a Crimson Guard. Excellent pickup versus illusion-based carries. It really works well against the PL in this case, but there's just so much other damage. There's all the magic damage from Alina. The Tusk has some. Of course, there's the Shadow Fiend. We haven't really even seen a Gigantic Requiem, but maybe it's getting close to his next item, and I think LGD just... Dyer's top, if they don't push now, they will be pushing within the next 5 to 10 minutes for sure.
Yeah. I'd love to see maybe just like pick up a Deso or something, go for the all-in push, but I imagine I'll go for something safer and it's going to be Butterfly. So making sure it can go well into the late game. And at this point, Butterfly, SMY, and the next Aegis is probably going to be a lane of Rax.
There's going to be a bit of a skirmish breaking out here though. Yao's in fairly deep. He's got a blink available. VP, they are lacking a bit on catch. We've talked a lot about it today. We've seen some drafts. IG comes to mind in the first series gods where they just didn't pick any stuns or lockdown, and it feels in general that those types of drafts are not working. There was the EG Klinks game the other day where they picked Klinks and they had zero disables to set them up. They have Winter's Curse. That's it, and it's an ultimate. I wouldn't say it's the only reason they're in trouble here, but it just makes it harder at this stage of the game where you don't have a comeback mechanic the way like a team with an Earthshaker or a Clockwork might.
Yeah, I think it's especially for a team like MVP.
They're going to look for maybe. He's Requiem. He's going in on three. And with Yao waiting in the wings, they'll find the IO. They want March as well, but he's got the Crimson Guard. He's tough to deal with. March will chase, but the Sigil covers the path of retreat. If they don't kill this thing off, there's no way they're catching maybe. And backup is coming, and they need to run now. But March is the one who's suddenly turned upon. Xiao8's got his Laguna Blade. QO's the obvious target here. KP joins the fray. March trying to duke it out. Xylar joining, and there's the Diffusal Blade. Right, the Omni Knight ult comes out, so March will get a little bit of sustain against this physical damage, but it's not going to help against the nuke. Xiao8 zaps him. The Laguna coming just before the Aghanim's is delivered, and now they look for more of the snowball towards the well. Here we go. Okay.
And buyback's going to get forced out. Bristleback, maybe even a bit preemptive there. The creep wave is still fairly far away, but LGD, even without an Aegis,
Sigil is just such a strong ability. This really feels like...
You're against three melee cores is the other thing. That's the other thing with this MVP draft. Three melee cores against Shadow Fiend, against PL, who will just fight those melee cores with illusions and Sigil. It's problematic.
Normally, Bristle is sprinting after you, but there he was like strolling in the general direction of LGD. And now it's just waiting for the Roche, it seems. LGD, Roche to respawn in 2 minutes. They got a little bit of waiting time, but we'll keep the lanes pushed out. Top lane is already being pressured. The jungle's occupied. The Dire Vision is good here. They've got a nice aggressive Observer Ward planted, and they'll just wait for this next Aegis, and then the high ground siege likely to commence.
It just doesn't feel like there's options for MVP. It's not even, like, you ask the question, what can MVP do? And it's... There really isn't comeback potential with this draft. The nature of this was very much... I mean, they were never going to dominate the lanes. Like, having a Slark mid was always going to be a weak point of their lane. They wanted to win the safe lane. The IO was meant to have a pretty big impact from, like, 5 to 15 minutes, helping the Bristleback find kills, and then the Slark maybe trying to get some punish onto the SF. But their mid-game, well, their, like, early to mid-game was just not
tower
happening.
Is under attack.
The big area where the Wisp also feels a little underwhelming compared to what we saw earlier today is... They didn't have an amazing hero to take advantage of it as far as farming. Like, you have the Bristle for Ancients, but he doesn't really need a Wisp to farm those. It just makes it a little bit easier. Whereas you look at, like, some other heroes that we've seen, Axe is a good example that comes to mind, or, you know, even someone like a Tiny. a Sven where they really need the Wisp to farm stacks efficiently and take advantage of it. It just doesn't seem like something MVP's draft was able to utilize.
Cure is so deep behind tier 2 towers. It's still a T1 bottom up, by the way.
Well, he's going to pay for that. Up to the ultimate. Maybe leaps enough TP's away. Oh, Sylar's waiting. Almost gets him. He's got to take these risks, though. QO needs to be putting pressure on the lanes. He's got to slow the game down.
Yeah, that's the right kind of moves from QO. I mean, this is... You're in desperation time. That's one of the few moves you can do. You look at this draft, you look at what your opponents have, a Shadow Fiend and a PL who are... At no stage of this game do you really feel like you're ever going to be able to fight if you QO. You just got to... You got to play this just... I mean, Eternal Envy calls it like suicide pushing, where you just push a lane until you die and just hope for the best. And that's not even really pushing the lane. He was creep skipping past two towers in the bottom lane, but that's like one of the few options he has.
Another walrus punch. QO this time may not be so lucky. He's got no ulti. Shall we? We'll finish him off. Collects his kill, and when a Slark is behind, this is where Lina gets very scary and tough to deal with. If he's ahead, he maybe has a big item at this point. Perhaps he can come out on top, even find solo kills, but Clark is just not a play from behind hero. Yeah.
Roshan has respawned, so LGD probably just going to be eyeing that off and look to play into a five-man push off of it, but now they have to worry. I mean, this foot push is, at this point, it's not threatening. It's not like the game against IG where it's IO tiny and something like, we have to make sure we're in a position where we can TP back in the defend. Here, it's like, they're not really split pushing, they're more just farming wherever LGD are not defending.
Here comes the push. No mana on March. LGD really don't feel they need it. And, well, with an Alpha Wolf here next to maybe the Dominator up, he's hitting for almost 300, actually a bit more damage. Each auto attack, 320. As they continue to go on to March, even through the Bristleback dropping low, they manage to pick up the Wyvern here just from PL Land Spam. And the Laguna comes in. They're forced to defensively relocate out, which frees up LGD to go right under the Tier 3 tower, looking for the 2-0 win and 10 points in 4 games. Nearly a flawless opening, just that one lost game to IG thus far. MVP, they need a miracle. They need more than a miracle to have a chance in this. They haven't even scratched the LGD heroes. They do everything they can. They buy back the Wyvern. LGD, I think they just go rush. They're like, we could probably end the game now anyway. But why even take that 1% chance that we have a terrible fight and we throw the game?
Yeah, Xiaowei TP's back to base, Seth's just buying up some items and...
I want a Shadow Blade. Or maybe a Glimmer Kit.
Yeah, I thought Glimmer Kit, but he has the money for it and he's not buying it, so it looks like it will be a Shadow Blade. Saying, I want to play a core style lane.
It's good to hunt a split pushing Slark, actually. Normally, you don't really see it on the support lane, but...
Yao kind of transitions into that support in the late game often, so...
You can see the difference in, like, say, the Yao build versus the Z-Freak Tusk that we were looking at for complexity, where he's getting a Desolator, an upgraded Silver Edge, and he just wants to one-shot people and play the carry role.
Solarcrest and...
This is the utility,
Glimmer Caves, that's the kind of items you see out of Yao. Blink Dagger, of course, this game, and...
If he tried anything else, Xiaowei might slap him.
It's like... You get these utility items, I'm the one who's going to get farm and carry.
March just standing here, but while he's... March is like, okay, I'm going to stand here and turn my back to them. And then maybe says, great, I'm just going to kill your Wisp instead, and then we'll deal with you if you dare to stick around. They do get a great Winter's Curse off, though, but Yao's Grave, the Winter's Curse canceled by a beautiful timing play by LGD. They finally bring down Yao, but it's right as everybody's forced back to the well. The Omni Knight don't even deploy. They only get a Tusk out of this exchange, and they lose the Rax. With the Aegis still online, maybe is more rich than anybody in the world at this point. He's richer than God. He's just going to go down to the bottom lane, work on a second lane of Rax, both cores at full HP in their prime and looking for kills if anybody takes a foot forward. They'll move on to the bottom lane of Rax. MVP, desperate for anything, might as well just run in and fight. You're not winning this one by stalling at this point. The Rax are dropping. Xiaowei didn't get it. Highlights Febby. This Wisp just can't survive for long. Now he's starting to toy with the Shadow Amulet. March looking for the kill. Does that to bring down the Lina. But March will pay with his own life soon enough to a flurry of PL Spears. The next kill. The Omni Knight chunked down by maybe. GG any second, it feels. Sure, you've killed the supporting cast. You can't even scratch the cores. They still have an Aegis, so maybe. Sylar's here just playing support, really. That's how gigantic the Shadow Fiend is. I never thought I'd see the day where Sylar is not the hero for any team he's on, gods, but maybe is that hero. This guy, I think he's going to be the story of TI. No matter how anyone else does, you look at the players coming into this event. The only other player who has a similar level of experience is probably Sumail on a top team, and maybe is just playing on a different level from anybody else.
It's been impressive. He has delivered game after game, even when LGD looked like they were in an unwinnable position against Cloud9, and his Ember Spirit just held on for days, and it's just a sight to see as we move. It's going to be really great to see how LGD match up against Secret tomorrow, and even in the main event when they get to the really big clutch matches. This is a player who doesn't seem to be fazed at all by the scale of TI5.
I mean, hell, they were backs against the wall yesterday against Cloud9, and he carried them so hard by himself, basically. On Ember Spirit, a hero that had a terrible win rate coming into the event, has been nerfed heavily and just generally doesn't seem popular for a variety of reasons, but look at him now. 11-0-5. Now, granted, I mean, we do have to go back to the way the game began. An MVP fed two kills, but they should not have, but
yeah.
It's not just that. He's used it so well. He hasn't made any mistakes the entire game.
Well, they're looking to hiding the noose here in the top lane, looking for mega creeps, and just nothing MVP have in their arsenal that can defend this, it feels like.
They continue to pummel this tower in the top lane. MVP
just ignoring Bristleback.
They only care about the Wisp. Debbie's dying to illusions at this point. He's got to walk back to the well and heal up. And while he's doing that, maybe and Sylar press in. They'll take down the tower. They've got another defusal charge ready. March is going to have to back out. He turns his back and they ignore him. Here comes the Requiem on to QO. Almost kills him off the bat. As soon as that ultimate ends, if he's 6 of her, he's going to get Laguna'd. There's the Zap. It's on Kate Gibson. March next. LGD swarming into the MVP base and hunting for Febby. The main prop. The relocate. He does make it out.
That's what a fail.
Meanwhile, elsewhere, dead Slark. And an effigy dead at the same moment. It's been a rough game here for QO. 1-6-0 gods. In the past, his Slark has carried this team to great highs, but here, it felt all but helpless against the Onslaught.
Just kind of outclassed in a lot of ways here. I mean, this is not a matchup MVP Phoenix would come into hoping for a win against, but this just puts MVP in an even worse position. They had losses yesterday against Complexity. They did have the one draw, but they still find themselves